You've probably seen graphs like these that show how much energy we consume. What if I told you they suck? In this video, we will see what the primary energy fallacy is and why it matters. Essentially, these graphs show what's called primary energy, which is the total energy before it's transformed, in the case of fossil fuels, before they are burned. The issue with showing primary energy is that we don't actually use or need all of that energy. What we actually use is called useful energy, which then provides us with services such as heating, cooking, driving, lighting, you name it. This Sankey diagram illustrates this point well, as it shows how much energy is actually wasted, called rejected energy. If you look on the right, you can see that almost two-thirds of the total energy is wasted, mostly as heat. This is because of inefficiencies, almost exclusively from fossil fuels. For example, a typical coal plant in the US has an efficiency of 35%. In other words, from the total energy, only a third goes to electricity, whilst the other two-thirds is waste heat. So the primary energy fallacy is the assumption that all primary energy from burning fossil fuels needs to be replaced with renewables. It doesn't. What needs to be replaced is the energy that provides us with the energy services. And since most rejected energy comes from fossil fuels, we essentially don't need to replace the insane amount of primary energy with renewables. Knowing this matters because graphs such as these can be used to inflate the importance of fossil fuels and paint a picture that it's impossible to replace fossil fuels with renewables. You shouldn't compare energy from fossil fuels with their waste heat versus renewables without this waste heat. It's true that the world is heavily reliant on fossil fuels, but graphs and numbers such as these don't really show an accurate picture. Essentially, due to electricity being more efficient, as well as the technologies that use electricity being more efficient, such as heat pumps or electric cars, we only really need to replace a third of the primary energy. To be fair though, we will need to account for storage losses with renewables. This example here clearly illustrates how electrifying makes the energy system more efficient and thus requires less primary energy. Here, we compare hydrogen and electricity for domestic heating. Due to electricity being more efficient than hydrogen, you can see that for the same amount of heat demand, we need much less wind capacity if we electrify homes through heat pumps than using hydrogen. In this example, it's 26 gigawatts for electrifying versus 150 gigawatts for hydrogen. A few assumptions are made in this illustration, which I've put in the description, but those don't really change the outcome. But there is also another issue with primary energy, which brings us to the second part of this video, which will explain how primary energy is calculated. When renewables weren't really around, primary energy made more sense, and it was easier to calculate since you weren't comparing apples and oranges. Now, with renewables that don't generate the waste heat, it's much harder. So let's cover the three main accounting methods that are used. In all methods, fossil fuels are the base, with renewables being the ones converted. The first method is the direct equivalent method, used by the UN and some IPCC reports. In this method, the conversion efficiency from renewables to fossil fuels is 1, or 100%. What does it mean? It means that for every unit of electricity generated by renewables, it is equivalent to one unit of primary energy. The issue with this is that to get the same amount of electricity as renewables, fossil fuels require much more primary energy, 3 times as much, due to inefficiencies. So if you compare it directly, like in this graph, then the amount of energy from renewables looks like it's basically fuck all. The implication of this is that people can use these types of graphs to show that renewables are completely insignificant and will never replace fossil fuels, which is completely misleading. So to correct some of these issues, two other methods were developed. The first one is the substitution method, PSM, used by BP and the US EIA. In this method, the primary energy from renewables and nuclear is equal to the amount of energy that would be necessary to generate an identical amount of electricity in conventional fossil fuel power plants. So you basically attribute the inefficiency of fossil fuels to renewables, as if they were as inefficient as fossil fuels. The energy efficiency of fossil fuels used by BP is 40% today, which is then the conversion factor given to renewables and nuclear. This illustration, for example, shows how 100 terawatt hours from solar becomes 250 terawatt hours using this method.
Since we're adjusting renewables upwards and essentially inflating the real energy produced, primary energy measured by the substitution method essentially overstates the amount of energy that's actually produced.
But it does compare renewables and fossil fuels more accurately, taking waste energy into account by making them more equal.
If you remember this graph that I showed previously with the direct method, as you can see, renewables are still somewhat fuck all, but there is a clear difference. In 2022, renewables were around 16% of primary energy with the substitution method, whilst only 8% with the previous method.
This method has other shortcomings.
Firstly, it doesn't take into account the many other inefficiencies that are removed when we decarbonize our energy systems. For example, heat pumps are much more efficient than gas boilers, and electric cars are much more efficient than petrol cars, which goes back to our main point, being that renewables allows us to reduce our total primary energy demand.
Another issue with the substitution method, which inflates total energy, is that it sends the wrong message. The message being that we need to increase our energy supply substantially from renewables instead of meeting the actual demand.
Finally, it can distort reality for countries that have very high shares of renewables, which at the moment is only the case with hydropower. This is the case with Norway, for example. If you inflate energy from hydropower in a country where hydropower is significant, by dividing it by the conversion factor of 0.4, you can end up with very high levels of energy consumption per capita. In this graph, you can see the difference between the substitution method and the method we are about to see, the physical energy content method. In one case, the energy per capita of Norway is much higher than the other. Final method is thus the physical energy content method, PEC or PECM, which is a sort of hybrid method between direct and substitution and is used by the International Energy Agency, OECD, and Eurostat. Here, the primary energy is calculated from the first type of energy that is useful, so either heat or electricity. For nuclear and certain renewables such as geothermal, it is heat, whilst from others such as wind, solar and hydro, it's electricity. All non-thermal energies such as wind and solar are given the 100% conversion factor, like in the direct method, whilst the thermal ones, such as nuclear, are given varying conversion factors. The two major changes are nuclear, which is given 33%, and geothermal, which is given 10% when used for electricity generation. The issue with this method is that, similarly to the direct method, it underrepresents non-thermal renewable energies such as wind. It also tends to overrepresent nuclear and geothermal energies, with one unit of electricity from geothermal being timed by 10 to get the primary energy. One thing the physical energy content method allows you to see better, though, than the substitution method, is the change in the share of renewables, as a higher share of renewables normally decreases the total primary energy.
So in summary, what are the implications of these problems, and why does it matter?
Firstly, it can be difficult to compare climate and energy scenarios that use different accounting methods. Comparing the targets of different individual countries can also be potentially tricky, as some methods can completely change the energy landscape of a country, which we saw with Norway. Then, it also affects the energy efficiency measure of countries, as one of the factors used in this calculation is primary energy. This is also the case with energy intensity per capita of a country. Remember how the physical energy content method gave a 10% conversion factor to geothermal? Well, for a country such as Iceland, this really increases the perceived energy per capita, which can matter if a country is trying to decrease its energy consumption. Finally, here you can see that depending on the method used, a country is more or less energy intensive than the others.
Therefore, as renewables start taking a bigger share in our energy mixes, continuing to use primary energy is most probably outdated and can be used to mislead people.
If possible, metrics that look at the more final uses, so either useful energy or final energy, are already better. Final energy, though, overstates the role of oil, as it does not take into account the efficiencies of technologies with cars, for example, but it's still better though.
I guess also, it would be good if reports and graphs would clearly state what method was used, instead of putting it in page 47 of the annex.
Thank you so much for watching. If you liked this video and want to learn more about climate change and energy, don't forget to subscribe.